Right, colleagues, firstly, it's good to be here. You know, as I was speaking to some colleagues in the afternoon, the question of debt can sometimes be a very boring issue to Zimbabwe, isn't it? Because I think it's not important. Because they think it's not important, or probably some think it's not really up for discussion yet. Now, for us, we think really this is the time to actually engage with this matter. Because I see that we have a mixed group of participants. I normally prefer ensuring that the participants are understanding where I'm coming from and my type of thinking. In some instances, I start with the conclusion so that you don't lose me along the way. But today I'll just mention things that are so obvious to many of you here. But for the purposes of the discussion, it's important to start from there. And the question that many people would ask is a very general question: where are we in Zimbabwe? How are things in Zimbabwe? The first response is probably there where you last understood them to be, meaning that there is nothing that changes so fast these days. But one fact is that we are in a political transition. That one is factual. It's not even my opinion. It was acknowledged. And the framework to take us through that transition is the global political agreement. And obviously, the global political agreement was put through because of assumptions, quite crucial assumptions that Zimbabwe must move from a particular state of affairs to the next state of affairs. And the assumption there is that what we would desire, what many people would desire, is that Zimbabwe emerges out of this inclusive government, this particular moment in transition, is a much stronger and democratic state. So we are hoping that the GPA may deliver a democratic outcome. That's our hope. We fully understand that no matter how defective it is, that's the instrument that has been entrusted with shepherding our transition. And so when I speak transition, then in the minds of many people, we know that the logical conclusion of the transition is an election. And many people again ask, so when is the election? And the response is quite simple. The elections are June next year, 2013. When exactly the current parliament's life or term of office expires on the 29th of March? And then these were harmonized elections, but we remained in an electoral period up to the 22nd of June. And then the constitution we are seeking to change now allows an election to be held between the end of the last election and 4 months thereafter. So it means we have an election by October next year. No doubt about it. There is no precedent in Zimbabwe of an election not being held when it's true. If it happens next year, it will be the first time that it's happening. So elections have always been held in Zimbabwe. What kind of elections is what we've always questioned? So, okay, this is the political sort of like update that many would want to hear. I will not dwell on the political question, but safe to say that, again, let's understand and agree that the transition that I spoke about is there to answer two questions. The first one is the political question, the second one is the economic question, and the two must run parallel in order for this to deliver. And the political question, which is not what I would work on, you would appreciate, is talking about delivering a free and fair election, because the background to it is that with the disputed elections, I mean, it's more than 27 June 2008, was disputed the world over, therefore it was a sham election. This is why we have a global political agreement and an inclusive government. So the issue of free and fair elections is a major issue. Being addressed through electoral reforms. These are ongoing processes. How far this has been done, I don't know. But it's about addressing rigging, dealing decisively with electoral violence, and respecting the will of the people, that is the outcome of the election. And then of course the political question again is also trying to deal with the reforming the public sector. For now, I mean, we understand that it's quite tedious, it's quite a long process to reform the security sector, but the attempt now is to professionalize it so that they don't sort of like meddle too much in politics. And then media reforms, dealing with repressive legislation, judicial reforms, criminal justice system, it's a mouthful. So others are more competent to talk about that. And then I'm dwelling on the economy question. The economic question has many things that are underpinning it, but just for us to understand, just as we said here, colleagues were talking about Zimbabwe's hyperinflation, isn't it? It went up to probably by November 2008, it was about 500 billion percent, isn't it? But then one of the biggest challenges that the inclusive government had was to make sure that they contained hyperinflation and they had one solution to it. Do away with local currency, introduce new currency, and then everything just falls away. So the moment the multi-currency was introduced, or the moment the use of other currencies was legalized in Zimbabwe, we went through deflation, which means inflation was below 0%, so it was really negative, and now it hovers in between 3% and 5%. But that sort of like gives you a picture. You may actually end up thinking that things are now back to normal in Zimbabwe, isn't it? The inflation question is being dealt with side by side with capacity utilization of industries, which is telling me about between.